Hi, I'm Nathan Hode, and I make an adventure game about our cat, Coco. But a couple of weeks ago, I took a break from that to have a go at Ludum Dare. So if you don't know what Ludum Dare is, it's a 72-hour game jam where you make a game from scratch based on a theme that gets revealed at the start of the jam. So the theme this time was deeper and deeper, and Lil had the idea of making a game called Deep Purr about cats. So I didn't have a whole lot of time for this Ludum Dare based on other commitments, but I figured I'd give it a go just to try out a few ideas for something I want to do in the Coco game, but in a more throwawayable context in case it doesn't work out. So let's have a look. So this is as far as I got. So the cats warp in. The idea would have been that they have like things that they need, like exercise or sitting in heat lamp for a bit, and then there's only so many stations and lots of cats just keep warping in, so it's like a resource management. So maybe like this one's ready for it's got enough exercise, so it's good for a heat lamp. Then this one's happy, so it then can warp out. So the idea is you're in like an underground facility that powers the internet by keeping cats happy. So as you can see, I didn't get overly that far, but it did let me test out something that I'm going to show you in this video, and that is Finite State Machines for Behaviour. So we'll jump into that. What do you think, Coco? Right, let's go. So in this video, I'm going to talk about Finite State Machines and how that relates to enemy behaviour in my adventure game. So if you don't know what a Finite State Machine is, it's basically just an object that can only be in one state at once. So for this example, it's each enemy can only be in one behavior frame of mind at once. So let's have a look at an example. So this skeleton enemy here can either be patrolling, chasing, attacking, hurting, or dead. So the general state machine itself is loosely based on the GD Quest example, with a little bit of the Devlog one that he talks about in one of his videos, which both of those things I'll link in the description. Okay, so first up, the skeleton will be patrolling, so it's following a path until it sees Coco, in which case then it jumps into chasing, which will be actively looking for Coco, so it will define a path and then follow that path. And then if it's close enough to attack, it will attack. So the attack state is just swinging its sword. If Coco is still close enough, it will swing its sword again until Coco is too far, then it goes back to chasing. Hurting is when Coco actually hits it, so that just runs a little animation and then flashes and goes back to whatever. Dead, I haven't quite finished yet, because I haven't animated it, but I'll get to that soon. Okay, so patrolling. So if I have a look at, I'll show you this example first so we can see what we're talking about. So patrol is, it will follow this path here until it sees Coco, and then it will actively seek Coco, and then as soon as it's lost sight, it will look around for a bit and then go back to the path. So let's see that running. So here's Coco, so you can see its sight area. So when it gets down to here, it will, let's make some room, it will see Coco. Oh, and then we start running. So you can see the red line is its like a debug path that it's following. So it went to where it last saw Coco, has a bit of a look around, can't see Coco, and goes back to where it was on its path. And then just keeps going. So when it hits the end of its path, it will just turn around and go back again. So we'll get seen again, and run away. So you see like if we can't quite run away, it will just keep following. Oh, saw us again, bam. So we'll hit it, let it hit us, ouch. And then it just keeps doing its thing. It missed me there. That's basically all there is to this, so let's see how that works. Okay, so in our actual environment, we have our skeleton, which we give it this navigation area, which I've defined as just the parts where it can walk. And we give it this line 2D, which is just the path we want it to follow. So in our skeleton, we've got patrolling. So patrolling will basically, if it's returning to the path, it will just find the bit that it was doing before and just go to it and keep going. And once it hits it, it starts follow mode, so just following the path. Hits the end, turns around, and goes back again, and just keeps repeating that until it sees Coco. In which case it emits this signal here. And actually on that note, so I have a few rules for these states. So the states are meant to be shared between entities. I say entities and not enemies because you can use them for like townsfolk or whatever, or non-enemy NPCs. And so you can never guarantee that a state will be a sibling of another state, so all you can do is emit the signal and let the parent handle that signal by transitioning state. So you can see here the Saw player signal is coming from trolling, so that's actually handled up in the parent that is Sword Skeleton itself. So on Saw player, we then transition to chasing. So you can see all the signals here. Any state transitions are handled by the thing that's implementing the state machine, none of the states or the state machine itself. So that makes things awfully simple. You can see all the different state transitions in one place, and also it means these things are shareable on their own. So all states need to be basically self-contained and define their own dependencies. So you can see in any given state, you've got all the stuff it actually requires. So like patrolling, for example, needs like the parent, it needs like this thing. Facing is like a direction, the direction is facing, so it can change its view vector. And then the play detection is a special node I've got that just detects when it's seen Coco and reports back. And animation controller is like an animation tree thing that handles the direction of a blend tree. And same sort of thing for pretty much all the states. So the point is you expose slots for anything that it needs, and then you fill those slots. So if we go back to 2D here, you can see like I've filled the slots with stuff that exists in the skeleton itself. And then the state can then, if it's assuming it's had all its dependencies met, it can then totally operate on its own. So after implementing a few of these, the general rules of states you should follow are they have to declare their own dependencies and they can't refer to other states. If you follow those two rules, it makes everything way simpler. So that's pretty much all there is to it. If you want me to go into any more detail about any part of this, then just ask in the comments and I can maybe make a follow-up video with more behaviours and how to maybe implement them in a non-enemy NPC. And until next time, I'll see you later.